Hello, it's 8 o'clock. It's Sunday evening. It must be ESC Fan TV and it must be Retrovision. If you haven't, then tonight it is 1998 that we are throwing ourselves back to. Now, before we get started, let's actually deal with the housekeeping. Don't forget, just down there, that like and subscribe button. Click it, click the bell as well. You get notified when we go live as well, and it will all be good. Now, also, it's worth mentioning, whilst you're on YouTube, you might think, oh, I'll like and subscribe on there. Don't think we begin and end on YouTube. Just take a look at our Facebook, our Insta, our Twitter, and you can join us on there as well. Now, let's meet the panel. Ah, what a smorgasbord of talent I have with me this evening. Obviously, I'm letting them shine out, which is why I'm dressed as a rather naff backing singer. Let's first of all go across to the wonderful Andy. Good evening, Andy.
Oh, good evening. Well, you know, I've come as Thalisath from Greece. 22 years later, I'm still bitter, very bitter, having come second last. I should have beaten Ghana International.
Well, it's good to see. But obviously, you did have some tough competition. And if we look over here, we've got the lovely Phil and Michelle. Good evening, Phil and Michelle.
Hi, I'm trying to be Gilda Horn, which is... Unfortunately, I've got a little bit more hair on top than he has, but only just.
Unfortunately. And I'm better than Andy because I came second.
Hey, yes, you're obviously playing the wonderful Imani as well. Now, we've also got, let's kind of now, hang on, let's work this out. Let's go that way. We have an ESC Fan TV Virgin this evening. It's Michael. Good evening, Michael.
Hello. Oh shit, my wig's fallen off.
Oh, making a great entrance. I love it. I love it. I love it.
Oh, jeez. Hello. Welcome. Yes, well, I represented in the 1998 contest and I came fifth, but I was song one, so I think I should have finished in first place. And I'm going to put my wig back on now.
Okay. Also joining us as well. They've rotated around to the same place. It's the wonderful Ian and Donna. Good evening, Ian and Donna.
Hey, hiya. Good evening.
Nope.
Hi. So this is Mikolas for this evening from Cyprus, who you'll get to see soon. And I've come as the lovely Katrina from Katrina and the Waves, and I'll be presenting all sorts of trophies later on, baby.
Hey, we love it as well. Just down there, we've got the lovely Joe. Good evening, Joe.
Hello from Slovenia.
Being the wonderful Billy from Slovenia.
Billy, I see from evening. Slovenia, yes. Hello, everyone, with the ponytail.
She makes a good man.
Yes. And also someone who seems to have dyed his hair for the occasion. Let's work out how I'm going to do this. It's Sean.
How dare you? This is natural. Hi, everyone. Nice to be back. I've come as Lars A. Fredriksen from Norway.
Wonderful. Now,
I love your kitchen.
Guys,
oh, cheers, darling.
Join in the chat room as well. Already, it's a good evening to Neil, to John Boy, to Lee, to Amit, to Jimmy, to Little John UK, and also a big hello to Stuart as well. It's already been mentioned in the chat room.
Can we have a look around Sean's kitchen?
Where's Stuart? In a moment. We're just going to cover... You know,
beautiful.
Stuart. And Stuart's decided to take the week off.
Far more interested in the retro room.
We'll do through the keyhole next week instead, shall we?
What did you do to earn all that, Dosh?
Oh, something very dishonest.
Andy. Yeah, I bet. Yeah.
Now, guys, let's get started on to the songs. So, the first question for the panel, really, is, well, Switzerland, poor Switzerland, got deux points. France only managed 3 points. Did they really deserve to come bottom of the leaderboard? take a look at the clips and let's see what the panel think. Ah, oh, what a wonderful selection. Do you know what, Andy, since you've got the scoreboard behind you, I feel like I should ask you the question first. Do these two really deserve to come bottom?
Oh, well, the Swiss song was shite, so yes, definitely. I mean, Christ, what were they thinking? The French song should have come third or fourth. It was lovely. One of my favourites for the year. She performed it beautifully. She doesn't have the best voice in the world, but for a song like that, you don't need the best voice in the world. It was lovely. Came too early in the running order.
I don't know. Joe, do we agree?
I don't know. I mean, I think it was the worst French entry ever. I think. Oh! Sorry, Lovely.
Bitch.
Yeah. So it really was. I just didn't think it. I mean, I love French's entries most of the time, but yeah, I was like falling asleep during that one, I must admit. Switzerland, yeah, very forgettable, have to say. Yes, they deserve to come bottom and bottom at one.
Well, Neil in the chat room says, Swiss, no points and lucky to get that many. I think the panel seem to be with you, okay, with it. Although Campbell does say, I fully agree, Joe, it's an awful French entry.
Hmm.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Ian and Donna, any thoughts?
Not much different. For me, France is worst. I agree, Joe. Sorry, Andy. Switzerland was
all right. I don't care.
Yeah, very frustrating.
Yeah, the Swiss entry, it's a nice enough song, but just meh. France, however, no, not a good song and not a good performance either.
Nah.
So I would have put France last.
And fight. You know what? I'm sorry. I'm just going to put Stuart's comment up just for Andy to read. I'll get Phil and Michelle's opinions first, and then we'll come back to it. Phil and Michelle, France and Greece, were they... France and Greece. France and Switzerland, did they deserve last place?
I thought Switzerland did deserve last place, but I like the French song. I thought it was really good. I thought the orchestra really well. It was lovely and orchestral. I loved it.
For once, I actually agree with Michelle. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I like the French one. But I also agree with Neil. Switzerland were lucky to get zero.
Yeah. It was a shocker.
Yeah.
Now, I have to admit, I seem to be the reverse for the panel because I actually quite liked the Swiss entry. I thought it deserved more than Norpois. But the French entry, I almost felt bad for France until I had to cut the clips for tonight's show and spent so long trying to find a decent clip of the entry. 3 points, maybe 3 points too many. I'm sorry.
I'll get on with it.
Let's move on. Now, Andy has pulled his wig through a shredder. He's come as Greece. Let's take a look at the song. Two beautiful songs there. Andy, were you really loved?
So the problem was they didn't let me sing in English, which I wanted to. I was on second and, you know, I can't do anything about that. But they wouldn't give me any video effects. If I'd have had the same video effects that Dana International would have had, I would have slaughtered her. The cow, she got all the video effects. She had a better running order and she was taller and she had better legs.
Now, of course, there was a bit of controversy, wasn't there, with the Greece act. Did anyone actually watch the Naked Eurovision special?
Well, we might have got a little bit upset, a little bit upset about things.
Yeah. just a little bit aerated.
And the manager might have been escorted off the premises.
And might have.
The band might have had a meeting to
decide whether or not they actually went along and performed.
Yeah, but Eurovision never, ever disqualifies anybody that doesn't stand a chance of winning. If they weren't going to disqualify Poland in 1994, they're never going to disqualify anybody. Not somebody who's going to come second last.
Admittedly, the Greeks did basically get points from the one country always guaranteed to give them points, and that was it, wasn't it? Mm. 12 points from Cyprus. That's the one.
Malta.
if I may say, I thought I'd come with a pretty accurate drag, but Joe's done a lot better. She's exactly like the Slovenian guy. Exactly like him.
Ah, yes.
I'll do my best.
What did you make of the Slovenian song, Joe?
Oh, yeah. What did I make of it? It's, I have to say, I wouldn't say I fell asleep doing it. That's rude and horrible. But yeah, it wasn't the nice sort of ballad that I actually do like. It was one of those that was a bit of a snooze fest. And he did deserve to come 18th, I have to say, even though his ponytail rocked. Which is why it was really easy for me to get in there, look, you know, long hair, ponytail. I'm like, it's every day. I look like him all the time.
Hey, rocking it as always. And Ian and Donna, if you had to take your pick, Greece or Slovenia, which one would you go for?
Oh, Slovenia every time, without a doubt. For me, Greece was a bit like drunken granny at a wedding. Although the guitars were nice. Mm. Always nice to hear a bit of guitar in Eurovision.
Never mind. I tell you what, guys, let's move on. There was actually a debut country in 1998. Which country do you think debuted? Who's done their research?
Well. Oh, yeah, it was
There we had the first ever Macedonian entry. Stuart Wilders loved this. Phil and Michelle, do you love the Macedonian entry, or do you think it was it a fair first entry as debut entries go?
No. It's as if they'd never seen the programme before.
I don't know. It was all right, but it was quite dated.
It was bad.
It was pretty ultra.
It was bad.
So, just as a quick question to the panel, if that fits along the worst Macedonian entry, I think probably fair to say, what represents your best Macedonian entry? Andy. This year would have been the best entry from Macedonia.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And last year's was all right, but it was not terribly boring, but she was a great performer. I'm pleased she did so well. Was that proud?
Yes.
I mean, I don't take that much notice, but, you know.
Of course, I preferred what everyone would expect. I preferred their 2000 entry, which was when they came back.
Oh, yeah.
2 years later.
XXL, no.
With 100, was it? It was 100%.
100%
Ljubljam. Yeah.
There wasn't a single note sung in tune.
Oh, but what a wonderful entry. Loved it. Loved it. Amazing. And in the chat room, Lee says that Dance Alone is the best Macedonian entry for me. Tim Gray says Proud was outstanding. Last year's was pretty good. And, you know, Stuart agrees as well. Now, move on.
I just got one point to say, Tom, if that's okay. Well, because that this was last in the running order, this means that it was the song that the last ever song to have an orchestra.
Oh, so it was.
Ooh.
So Macedonians to blame.
Yeah, they thought, sod that.
They also got the deciding vote as well, didn't they?
He did, yes. And he was wearing a lovely suit.
He was.
He did. And more on Macedonia's deciding vote later when we look at the top very top of the school board. But should we liven things up? Now, I'll let you into a secret. My dad actually put money on Poland to win this contest. If you think that money was ill-placed, take a look at the clip.
She had no tits.
Are you saying that why my dad lost his money on that song, Andy?
Oh, maternally, yes.
Mike, I laughed so hard, I lost my wig off.
My brother used to vote for whoever was showing a little bit of an unintended cleavage.
It didn't work.
Absolutely. Absolutely. No.
Michael, what did you think of the Polish entry?
Love it. I thought she looked good. In fact, I thought she looked absolutely beautiful. I think the song was good. I think it was worthy of a top 10 place. Yeah, it should have done a lot better than what it did. Definitely. Love it.
And the English translation is When Love Turns to Hate. You can actually find that around on YouTube somewhere.
I've got it.
So, oh, there we go.
She also, on the evening, I was there on the evening, she got a big reception in the hall. And I honestly really did think she'd get a top 7-8 place, definitely. Shame.
They all got a good reception, in fairness. Well, apart from the shit from Greece.
Hungary. Remember Hungary?
Yeah, Hungary. Mm. And Macedonia. Yeah.
Now, Sean, you wanted to talk about Poland as well.
I just thought it was dull. I did. But also, I mean, I don't know what's worse, that song or Andy's makeup Norwegian tonight. Yeah, well. Thanks. no, but it's a crap song.
Show us around your kitchen instead.
We can't just spend an evening looking around his kitchen.
Oh, we!
I can't remember.
Obviously, included in that clip as well was Spain, with a song that I totally can't pronounce. Ian and Donna, any better on the pronunciation of it?
No, nope. But the English is "What am I going to do without you?"
Que voy a hacer sin ti?
Que voy a hacer sin ti?
Que voy a hacer sin ti?
Nice. Well done.
Que voy a hacer sin ti?
What am I going to do without you?
Yes.
Well, fuck knows, but if you sing a song like that, you're worth it. Yeah.
Dressed as Ben Elton in an Undertaker's outfit. It's all.
He should have stuck in at Wizard School. He'd have done much better.
Exactly.
I have to say, though, I did think the Spanish entry was almost very Doctor Who-ish in how he dressed, actually. I know you say about... But
yeah, Doctor Who 1984.
It was, wasn't it? With the long jacket and stuff. Very foppish.
Yeah. Kind of frock coat.
It was shite. It was shite.
But, you know...
It was shite.
Very unforgettable, unfortunately, that's
Now, obviously, Neil points out that by this point, obviously, very few countries were using the orchestra. And we move further up. Now, Finland and Estonia, I actually remember the Finnish entry mentioned by the Mail on Sunday, no less, before Eurovision, as a potential contender to win the contest.
Wow.
So, Phil and Michelle, was it a potential winner to win the contest?
Finland. For me, I thought it was a great song if you're suffering from insomnia. Because, honestly,
it was just, shut up. You're shouting rubbish.
And the other thing, interesting thing, is if you look at the lyrics, there are only 6 words in the entire song repeated over and over again.
I loved it. I liked how it was all mellow and then it went a bit barking and then it went mellow. And you get extra points for obviously all the stupid instruments that they have because nobody needs all those. Yeah. I liked it.
Is a ceramic pot really an instrument?
Are you all right? Do you need a hug?
No,
you're right.
I have to say, the chat room says, you know, Finland, the song makes Finnish sound like a made-up language.
She fluffed a high note as well. Right at the very end, it was meant to go way up, you know, like Laponia high. Mm. But she had a cold, poor lass. Oh. So she fluffed it.
Now, Tim says that Finland was worthy of last place. Estonia was a beautiful ballad, though. Andy, was it a beautiful ballad?
Well, I don't know. I was more interested in the camera work because 1998, they got a whole load of new cameras on movable trucks and things. And there was a camera way over him that was shining down on him. And when it all swirled round and they were showing the pianos, it's like he had to concentrate on his piano playing and singing at the same time, which is fucking difficult, I can tell you. But it got spots. And he was a bit of a child. No, it was all right. It was a good song, but... what we're looking for?
Well, do you know what? I was thinking to myself that in some ways I kind of prefer that performance to the performance he made with his great Eurovision comeback a few years later.
Lost in Corona.
Although the song is better. Lost in Verona, amazing. I'll take to the dance floor anytime you like with it. But the performance he gave on the stage when it came to Lost in Verona was almost like he didn't really want to be anywhere near her, and she didn't.
Well, they were trying to do Return to Yesterday. That's what they were trying to recreate, and it didn't work.
No, it didn't.
And why would it?
Different song as well. To be fair, it wouldn't.
True.
You know, the impact of it, totally and utterly, you know, different. But
anyway, we haven't spoken about Greece for a while. She was robbed. Absolutely robbed she was.
Yeah, whilst everyone thinks about being robbed by Greece, perhaps people would like to think about the dawn. Was it? Some say we've reached the dawn of Armageddon as 1999 is getting near. What song could I be talking about?
Oh, I've no idea. Well, it's one I've got a clue what I'm playing now. Oh, no, not that.
So which one of those two songs do you think had that lyric if it was translated in English?
Good question.
Any ideas, anyone?
We weren't listening.
Cyprus.
It was.
Yeah, possibly Cyprus.
If you listen to the English translation, it actually has. Some say we've reached the dawn of Armageddon as 1999 is getting near.
That's
does
nice
that
cheery.
Improve yeah. the performance anymore for you, Ian and Donna?
Well, as I didn't know that... it didn't help me, but I enjoyed that performance. He had a really good stage presence and a great vocal and a nice whistle that made it very appealable to the Irish delegation. I actually quite liked it. It was nothing earth-shattering,
but
pleasant.
The one thing also very rare to hear on a big professional show like that, about 30 seconds in, there's a real screech of feedback from something.
Yeah.
Which is very unusual, and fair play, I'm not getting caught out by that because it was quite a sharp.
This is your professional side coming out, isn't it, Ian?
It is, but it's quite noticeable. It's on the broadcast
so
as well.
Tell us what you do for a living.
I mostly do sound engineering for theatre and lighting as well.
You'd be forgiven if you thought he looked more like a proclaimer than he does
thanks.
A technician. Sorry.
And I'm sure you've walked 500 miles in your job.
Yeah, that sounds like quite a few jobs. Yeah, the air show being the worst of them.
Now, Also in that clip, we had Portugal. Now, Phil and Michelle, I was surprised this came so far up the scoreboard. What about yourselves?
Yeah, I was, because who doesn't love the sound of bagpipes? Said nobody ever.
Well, you've not just got bagpipes, you've got the Portuguese guitar,
you've
got a strange square drum. I think you've got an accordion in there somewhere. It was like a right mix of all instruments that nobody wants to hear.
It's pick all the instruments that buskers that can't play proper instruments have and put them on stage all together. You might as well have had primary school kids with recorders going as well.
Yeah, he had the dwarf as well, didn't it?
Oh, it was awful. I
know Sean has got something to say about Portugal. I think he has a slight affinity with it.
Fucking bagpipes.
Yeah.
Fucking hate bagpipes. Love dwarfs. I love dwarfs all day long. I saw three at the same bus stop once. It was amazing. But no, I hate bagpipes. Ian, he's Scottish and he wants bagpipes at the wedding. So I don't know how that's going to go. But probably not very well.
Well, I have to say, the opinion contradicts. Wes Brooks says, no, Portugal is gorgeous. Tim says with Cyprus, you know, he loves the Cypriot song, a real belting performance. But I'll tell you the entry I had, in actual fact, two of my favourite entries coming up next. First of all, you've got the lovely ballad from Sweden, and then you've got Dawn Martin rocking it out for Ireland. Take a look at these. Ah, wonderful stuff there from Sweden and Ireland. Ah, Charlotte and R, Joe, Jill Johnson, what did we think?
Oh, I love her. Beautiful lady. And it really was the start of her, you know, winning Melfest in 98. And then so the start of her career. And she's still one of the most popular and famous people in Sweden now, I believe. Mm-hmm. You know, as a country singer. You couldn't believe it. She was like, what was it, 21, 22 there?
Oh, no, yeah. 45.
Seriously, I think she's younger than me, and I'm sure she was. I think I said she was born in what, 1976, I think she said something like that. 76. And to be fair to her, she's you know, she's still going. I've listened to a couple of her songs more recently. Yeah, really lovely. But that is definitely the best for me that she's done. She should have done better. I was expecting, you know, them to be like at least sort of, you know, top three, top five.
It was a bit of a Lady Di, Why Did You Have to Go and Die song, though, wasn't it?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, was it Charlene Gannard translated as lovely, loving or something?
Oh, lovely dead princess, it was translated.
It wasn't, not quite.
It was.
Do you know what? I quite liked it, and I loved her cloak thing, draping jacket, kind of spread
gorgeous
across
outfit.
The stage. It was amazing.
Yeah, a lovely top. Yeah, nice.
She did the song justice. As Tim says, it's a classic song from Sweden. Little John,
I thought she was about 50.
How the hell did it not get top five? The favourite Swedish entry ever. Neil points out it's the last song Sweden ever sent to the contest in Swedish.
Oh yeah.
Well. And Neil also points out that Jill was induced into the do you induce someone into the Mellow Hall of Fame?
Induct.
That's the word we're looking for. Induct into the Mellow Hall of Fame. Now, also accompanying that, we had a lovely wee ditty from Ireland. Michael,
it's always over now.
What did you think of Dawn's big belting song?
I think she did a belter. I really, really did. And I probably think out of all the songs that was in, I do think she came round about where she should have come. The fact that she had a voice, because she was partying so hard that week, because Birmingham is only down the road from me, and I was down there from about the Tuesday onwards, and she was pissed most of the week. And the fact that she actually got up and performed and did the performance that she did was a blessing. She was brilliant. I loved her. Love her.
And Sean, what did you make of the Irish entry as well?
Oh, Michael, you're going to hate me, but I just didn't like it. I think it only came ninth because it was Ireland and they'd like won the last four out of the last six contests. It's just, it's a depressing song. It is. She said she would promise the earth and you only broke my heart, and she's questioning if her feelings are ever right. I mean, Christ on a bike. I think it's more it'd be more depressing having to self-isolate and having nothing to watch but EastEnders. It's crap. Sorry.
Also, it only makes sense with punctuation because it is always over now.
Yeah.
Which you should have done that in a dance, didn't you?
What? Put a comma in.
Over now.
It would have worked, I think.
It was
but
shit.
You know what? I think it was Ireland up to their usual 90s standard. I had a sneaking admiration for the song. But I did love the rock sound in her voice as well.
Mm-hmm.
She kind of
that was the booze.
Out. Yeah.
I thought she would have been sick a bit in her throat.
I thought she was quite nervous.
Yeah, she was only 21 at the time, wasn't she?
Stone?
Really? So, I think she did a very good job. Anyway, should we go for something a little
Moving
bit
on.
More
I've got to be exciting. Careful. She's one of my Facebook friends, so I've got to be careful.
Oops, gorgeous. She's
Hi,
gorgeous.
If you're watching. Love you, really.
Your kitchen shit, Sean.
guys, let's just move on. Let's go for something a little bit more exciting. Let's climb away.
Come on.
Sean, the resemblance is brilliant.
I know. Bob on.
Brilliant resemblance there. And Ian and Donna, Norway.
Yes.
Was a step up from their 1997
Nullpois? Just a tiny bit. No, it was great. I mean, if you want to look like a fisherman's friend and have a mediocre song, it's fine. It was okay, really. It needed a bit more pizzazz, I think, for me. Just kind of occasionally looking back in singers to kind of go, I'm there. I'm doing it. Yeah. But it was nice enough. What do you reckon?
Yeah, it's a nice enough song. It's nice, but really dull Scandi pop, but it's good. But best thing was, what a cardigan. That is a great jumper.
Mine's better.
I like yours, Sean. Definitely.
Yeah. I have to say, this from is, a cutting edge TV show.
She's even got the necklace right as well. It's a
shoelace. It's a shoelace and tinfoil.
Tinfoil rocks in this show.
Well, I have to say, Stu has said, has Sean borrowed one of Reg Dwight's wigs for the evening? just gonna throw that one out there. Climbing all over the stage, we had the wonderful Gildo Horn. So, our very own Gildo, Phil, what did you make of Germany's entry?
Oh, this is what Eurovision's all about. It was fantastic. I mean, the guy singing a song about how he loves everyone, because Jesus loves you and Gildo loves you. the people I feel sorry for are the cameraman and the director, because he was all over the place, charging around into the audience, backwards and forwards across the stage. Then he leaps onto a balcony and climbs over. I mean, I dread to think what the health and safety bloke was thinking when that was going on, but yeah, it was fantastic. Absolutely loved it.
I got a whiff of he lives with his mum still.
No, he gives her his washing every other weekend.
Yeah, well, that's it. Well, he wrote the song, composed all the music, made his own outfit on his mum's sewing machine sort of thing. You know that he's not allowed to live on his own. He's got that vibe about him.
Wes says, Gildo, Gildo, more Gildno. Poor Gildo. Whereas Stuart is a huge fan. And Neil points out that Gildo won the second ever Barbara Dex Award. And if you were watching Eurovision again last night, you will have actually seen Malta's entry, Debbie Skerry. And that was the first ever winner of the Barbara Dex Award. So if it comes up in a Eurovision quiz, you know it's there. Now, Joe, you've got an interesting story to tell us about Gildo, haven't you?
About Gildo? I do. Because, living sort of near Birmingham myself, not able to afford the tickets. It was, hard times for me with my first ex-husband. Great. But I did hang around the arena a little bit, like, pre-selfie days, but I still thought it'd be nice just to say hello to a few people. And I saw Gildo being interviewed for I don't know which TV station, but he was actually balanced on the wall. And if anyone knows the old NIA, it does have the canal surrounding it and a wall, literally, with a very big drop. And he was actually on the wall. And somebody on the boat went past on one of the barges and shouted, "Gildo, don't jump." And he turned around and he said, "No, tonight I sing, tomorrow I jump." And that was it. And I loved it. And of course, it came up on TV. I don't know which station it was, but it was fantastic. And I was there and I witnessed it and it was great. I was right next to him when he did that. It was a really nice experience and a nice little tale to tell forever.
And an amazing story. And I can't help but feel that we've lost Miss Sulkalot from Greece. And
she'd had enough, clearly.
Well, darling, we really need Stuart for the really good drag, but I'm doing my best.
is that your Jean-Paul Gaultier, by any chance?
It might be my Jean-Paul Gaultier, exactly, yes. Not even wearing a polo neck.
Amazing, amazing. And of course, we'll be looking at Dana International performance very, very, very soon. But I tell you what, let's go a little bit further up the scoreboard. There's a wee youngster from Belgium, and there was someone with a fantastic Croatian performance.
I'm not really concentrating. Here we go. Sorry,
this is going so well, isn't it?
I'm sorry, but I've been getting changed. I'm being concentrated.
And I'm assuming Michael is trying to do a reveal for us. I'm not quite sure what's going on there.
I think he's on the wrong website, don't you?
We've gone to black.
Is that a better offer?
We'll come back in a bit. To Michael.
I thought Grindr had done Grindr. Oh, she's there. Oh, she's there.
Is she? Are we back?
Give her a chance. Give our Daniela a chance.
Oh, Daniela, are you there? Oh, are you there. You're very dark.
Turn
though,
the fucking
darling.
Light on, you daft bitch. It's not.
You need to put 50p in meter love.
That's the thing with Simola. I'll tell you what, he's on mute as well. Hang on, there we go. Well, it's getting there, ladies and gents. It's
never going to be invited back.
We never need to do a bloopers show, do we? You can just replay this one.
Oh. Les says, Daniela was just a goddess, loved her as much in 95. Tim says, you wouldn't think an audience would get so excited about someone taking their coat off. Yeah, Madonna we've got someone putting their coat on. Now,
Madonna had done the same thing, though, just beforehand, but she had a white coat and a black dress underneath.
Oh, did they?
Yeah, on Frozen. On Frozen.
Oh, yeah, of course they did.
Yes.
Yeah. It went fucking dark then, didn't it?
Someone turned
them
off.
Hello, darling.
Hello.
Have we got a big reveal, Michael, or not?
Oh, dear.
Sorry, say that again.
Have we got a big reveal? Ne kami ne.
Me ne kvane. Nek mane manek mane budre. There you go.
Oh,
for one night only.
She's spoiling
it. You.
Stuart would want to know what you're doing because he thinks he just saw your knickers. But
I just got my tits out. I know that much.
Lee, on the other hand, loves Croatia. Such a great opener to the contest. And she is absolutely amazing. Sean, what did you make of the Croatian entry?
You know what? I loved it. It's not the kind of thing I normally like, but I thought it was... I thought she had a lovely voice. It's a beautiful song, quite a sad song. And as far as costume changes going, I mean, you can't have a Eurovision Song Contest without a costume change. It was rather elegant, I thought. No, elegant, not elephant, Michael.
Oh, you're there. Is that for Mike's kitchen?
Wes has pointed out an interesting comment. The contest started with someone singing Hold Back the Rising Sun and ended with Somebody Stop the Dawn, which is a fascinating fact. Fascinating fact indeed. Now, we also heard there as well Melanie Cole in what I think was one of the better Belgium entries, with Dewey. Phil and Michelle, was this something that took your fancy?
It was all right. I mean, it's probably just not my kind of thing. It was nice enough. I mean, she sang it well. A bit of a dance to it. It was okay.
No, she looked like she'd just come from the office, dressed like that, and a song as boring as if you worked in an office. I don't know how I can say. Dull.
I think it does prove that, you know, if white was the in colour of the 80s, as we saw when we did Retrovision 86, Torp was trying to be the in colour of 1998, but I don't think it really worked.
Beige. Who wears beige? Nobody.
I don't think it really worked. Well, that's true. Who does wear beige? Mm. Not many people.
No.
It does say a lot about you, doesn't it, if you wear beige.
Now,
we
are
Sean's wearing beige.
Yeah, but he's not exactly. He can get away with it. Now,
at least I'm wearing something, Michael. I mean, what's going on there, love?
I'm covering me. Okay.
He's doing something. Now, guys, we're heading into the top four. Now, obviously, the next two songs were potential winners. And in a voting as tight as anything, I think at least one of those countries could feel incredibly hard done by when the final tally was added up. Let's take a look. Oh, absolutely, absolutely brilliant. Now, if we just look at this, you can see going into the final round, you can see from the scoreboard on the screen, it was Israel and Malta on 166, yet Malta only managed third. Joe, was Kiara robbed?
Oh, she was. I think that was the deserved winner. Obviously, not counting the UK, because let's face it, Imani was the deserved winner. But yeah, I do think that she should have won. I was expecting that voting. I was expecting 12 points. I really was. I remember it very well. Sort of sitting there thinking, oh my God, they're going to give it to 12. They're going to get to Malta. Oh, okay. And it was, you know, and what did they end up with? I can't remember. Was it Croatia or someone? And it's sad. Right. It's just really sad that, and they never really panned to her, did they? You know, I was expecting
them to be certain about whether she was in love or not. I think that I'm in love. Oh, fuck off. Either you are or you're not. Surely you know.
Okay. She's cute. And the thing is, I don't care what anyone said and all these actually, that's the best entry of hers for me, was her first one. It's amazing. No.
Now, Angel.
Michael, what did you make of Yara? Was it her best song?
Totally agree with Joe. The One That I Love was an amazing, amazing song. At the night, I remember it really vividly. It just got a standing ovation midway through the song. It was an absolute classic. And I, for one, was gutted that she didn't win. I really, really was. I think it was the standout song of the night. Now the Candelabras did it.
The chat room has gone berserk over this one. Oh, adorable Kiara. Tim says, I'd have been delighted if either of those had won. Neil, I was amazed that the UK ended up above both of these. We'll come to the Dutch song in a moment. Mm-hmm. Wes doesn't entirely get the love for Kiara. Amit says that Malta's song is great. Boy, it's the best of her three songs that she presented. I have to say, I do agree with Campbell, though. You know, I don't think that Sack with Buttons Kiara Ward did her any favours. I have to say, there's one thing I could change about her performance, it would be the dress.
Yeah.
Genuinely would have changed the dress for something. And that's the one thing I think she got right in 2005.
The wink.
Be careful what you say.
In 2005, she wore a stunning red dress, and I think that would have suited her 98 performance really nicely. Mm. Now, also, in that clip, we had the Netherlands, Hemel and Ada, Heaven and Earth. Andy.
Come over to me.
Oh, they don't get any better than this as a Eurovision song. I don't have a favourite Eurovision song because I can't decide between quite a few, but this is one of them. Mm-hmm. It's just brilliant. Yeah. And the addition of the orchestra lifted it. Ed Celia is a fantastic performance. It should have won. I can understand why Down on International did. And it was a great song, but this was definitely my favourite that year.
And of course, she was robbed again in 2007.
No, she wasn't. She
didn't qualify.
No.
On Top of the World, I love it. Amazing song.
Better in Dutch.
Should have got through in 2007.
Should have got through, but it was better in Dutch, and the performance wasn't as good.
And Michael, what did you make of the Netherlands song?
Again, my top three of that year was Malta, Netherlands, United Kingdom. I would have been happy if either three of those would have won. They're brilliant.
Now, we've had a query, and it's for Ian via the chat room. Mm-hmm. And so I'd like to know from the sound engineer guy what he thought of the Dutch production.
Very good. It certainly sounded the slickest and fullest production of the night, I think. I think it's one of the reasons it stands out as a good song. It is really, really well produced, and it comes across really well live. A lot of the other ones, there are weak places, the balance of the orchestration, the vocals, maybe it's not quite on. This is absolutely spot on. It's very nicely done.
Yeah. So, and I think, yeah, I totally agree with that. I love that song. It's an amazing song. Song.
Yeah, I'd forgotten about this song until we rewatched it. It was like, bloody hell, yeah, this is good.
It's a shame it kind of got overlooked by what I think were probably larger characters. It wasn't necessarily the song, it was the characters that kind of overtook it.
Yeah, totally.
The controversy and all sorts of
all that's like
behind the scenes stuff.
Now, speaking of controversy, obviously the Netherlands was party to a controversial moment, isn't it? Andy, would you like to explain our controversial moment?
Ah, yeah. Well, it was all a bit of a mistake, really, because in the rehearsal on the Friday, what's her name? 4x4?
Corrie van der Bos.
Ulrika.
Ulrika. Ulrika said to the Dutch presenter, of course, you were in Eurovision some time ago, and she goes, oh, yes, it was 1965, and it all went fine. On the night, it all went tits up because there was a little bit of a timing difference, and Ulrika ended up saying, long time ago, was it? And the whole of the stadium just erupted and carried on and on and on and on with mass hysteria. And it was a beautiful moment. There was no harm done, right, but it was just delicious. Have we got a clip of it, Tom? Please.
We haven't got a clip of it.
Oh, God almighty. Sack
me. It's fine. I've actually got that's the reason why I'm here tomorrow anyway. Obviously, the top two, it was Israel, and somewhat surprisingly, I think, given the way the voting panned out across the whole night, the United Kingdom sneaking in its 15th second place. Take a listen and see if you think these were deserved. Viva la Ria, viva Victoria, Afrodita. Viva la diva, viva Victoria, Cleopatra. The storm will call your name. You got you. Love could be the flame beside you. If you are lost in chains. Oh, where are you now?
Indeed, where is she now?
Sean, the United Kingdom's entry.
Oh, I think this is one of the best UK entries. I really, really do. Shame we didn't win. It's an absolute stonker. It's a moody, thumping house track. It should have won. It's, yeah, like you say, it's the 15th time we've come second. We've not come second since, unfortunately. We've not won it since. We've not come second since. It's such a shame when you think about if you look at all the postcards from this 1998 Eurovision, and in the background you had they were showcasing so many UK top artists, M People, Duran Duran, Pet Shop Boys, Manic Street Preachers, The Verve, just massive acts with some unbelievable tunes, and to think that we can't actually come anywhere near the left-hand side of the leaderboard anymore, when you consider that, it's really such a shame. But that's another discussion completely. But yeah, Imani, where are you now? Where are you? Oh, I loved it. Absolutely love it. It's one of my favourite UK entries, definitely.
And I am sure the BBC had a slight heart attack over some of the voting, because I'm sure there were times when it did look like 1999 was going to have to be the UK's year again. Phil and Michelle, were you waving the Union flag with pride in 98?
Oh yeah, this was an absolute belter. I absolutely agree with Sean. It was a fantastic song. It well-deserved second place. A bit of a strange dance routine from the backing singers, but apart from that, it was brilliant. She sang it well. It was a good song. Liked it.
First loser. Bad.
Aww.
Well, yeah. I know, but... Second place.
First loser. If you don't win, if you don't come first, you're last.
Second place. Now, obviously, the winner, the crown, went to Dana International, who did leave Terry Wogan and Ulrika Johnson. And Katrina herself actually stood waiting for the
reprise.
Reprise, yeah. That's the word.
Terry did so
for.
Well to fill time. It was quite a moment. Felt like forever.
She went to get her Jean-Paul Gaultier. I do think they missed a trick, because having watched the 1997 contest last night, I was reminded of how basically Ronan Keating was literally stood there to grab Katrina and literally just drag her.
Drag her.
Held just by like, force.
You have
so the reason that she didn't wear the Jean-Paul Gaultier for the competition performance is because of the lighting. So the whole of the set was all determined by this fancy lighting kit. And when she wore her outfit like this with the feathers, it created too many shadows on the floor. So they decided to ditch it at the last moment. And when she won, she felt sorry for Jean-Paul Gaultier and decided she was going to be a drama queen and change into it.
Now, Tim says, Israel was overrated and based on performer rather than the quality of songs. In
Marvel, No.
Absolutely.
Is this a fair comment? You know...
That was a good song and a terrible performance.
Did Ghana International deserve to win that year, or in such a tight year, should it have gone to someone else?
I think the song deserved to well, the song was a good song, and deserved to win because it was very popular. Ghana International was a terrible singer. She was very lucky. She was really lucky.
I see Joe's nodding in agreement.
I remember Amsterdam last year very well, and I'm not going to say any more than that.
Was it
an earplugs time? Yeah, because she was one of the singers for Eurovision in Concert, and then she did the after party, and although we wasn't present to actually watch it, because by that time we'd sort of decided we didn't want to see her and was looking after a friend, and we could hear her, and it was an earplug moment, I think. It was horrendous, absolutely horrendous. She can't sing for toffee, sorry. She really couldn't. You know, and yet, you know, you've got, and yeah, the song was really good, but it was her as a personality and the publicity, because let's face it, as that, she's amazing. And that's what won in the end. It wasn't really a song contest that year. It was more of a personality win.
But Eurovision fans always turn on the winner, sooner or later. Doesn't matter who they are. Eventually, we get the knife out and we dig it in their back.
I saw her at the Greatest Hits as well, and even in that, when she was doing that live, it really. When she was doing it with Conchita, and I actually thought, oh God, Conchita just walked the floor with her, because her vocal really wasn't as good as it could be. And there are some interesting notes in that song, which I hardly hear, but even so, she really didn't do herself justice, bless her.
I have to say, I agree with Neil. Am I the only one who thought the woman standing behind a mic stage right was doing all the heavy lifting vocally?
I have to say,
Neil, I totally and utterly agree with you. And if you haven't spotted it, guys, just over stage right, she doesn't get involved in the routine or anything.
Yeah,
she's literally there the whole time. She seems to do a lot of the vocal work.
They had to separate her so that the others didn't get put off by her vocal compared to theirs. So,
in fairness, Ghana International also didn't have much of a performance, because all she did was just walk across the stage. So she was giving herself the best chance of doing a half-decent vocal performance. She was dreadful during the week. I mean, she was just appalling. And the best performance she did was when it counted.
Now, guys, our love letter to 1998 is basically at a close. It's sad times. Now, there will be some people out there thinking to themselves, hang on a second, there's going to be a watch party on Wednesday and we don't know what year it is yet. Oh,
come on, tell us.
Drum roll,
go
please.
On, drum roll.
Wednesday watch party will be 1992.
What, 2?
Yeah, we are.
I'm not watching 1992. 1992.
Bloody hell. We're going to see.
They don't come duller than that. They do not come duller than 1992.
Aww. We are going to see Mr. Eurovision gain his third victory. We're going to see the UK claim yet another second place with Michael Ball. And hopefully,
it was a great song.
Now, guys, all that leaves me to do is say goodbye to my amazing panel. And goodbye to Sean.
Oh, tatty bye, everyone. Maybe see you next week, maybe not.
Now you know it's 1992.
It's goodbye. Ian and Donna.
Bye. See you, folks. See you later.
It's a big goodbye to Phil and Michelle.
Bye, everyone.
Ta-da.
See you.
Big goodbye to Michael.
Bye-bye.
Big goodbye to Joe.
Goodbye, everyone.
And a massive goodbye to the diva of the night. It is the wonderful Andy Brooke.
See you next year in Jerusalem.
Oh, yes. Don't forget that trophy's heavier than it looks. Now, we will see you very soon. In the meantime, please click the like and subscribe buttons, and we will see you, hopefully, for our watch party on Facebook on Wednesday night. Until then, thanks for participating, and we'll see you later. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.